Hi, I'm Mike Boland, analyst with BIA Kelsey. I'm here in San Francisco, which is the site of our upcoming BIA Kelsey Now, which is a conference that's going to focus on the local on-demand economy, or as we're calling it, the Uberification of everything local and all of the different local service verticals and categories that BIA Kelsey has been examining for decades. So as part of this process to put together this conference, we've been putting together the program and assembling the speaker roster. And two of those speakers are Michael Yang from Comcast Ventures and Will Su from Mucker Capital, both companies with portfolio investments in this LODE area. And we recently had them on stage in December to really start that discussion of what is their investment criteria and what are the opportunities they see in this area. So we're going to continue that discussion on stage at the BIA Kelsey Now conference, which is June 12th here in San Francisco. But as really a preview to that, we decided to make a montage video of some of their stage clips from our recent conference, which they started to introduce and highlight their views on the opportunity. So, following this is a quick kind of highlight reel of some of their thoughts. And we look forward to engaging with you more on this topic. And hopefully, we'll see you June 12th in San Francisco. So, I'm Mike Boland. Thank you for listening.
I think to look at local, I always look at it in two ways. One is the dimension of what's the consumer experience and how do consumers look at it, and then the merchant, the business, or the advertiser. I think many years ago when I was more at Yahoo, kind of operating in the space, it was very much more about local advertising, local media, and about search. And that was kind of the dominant paradigms. Consumers were searching. And then on the sell side, everyone was selling advertising-oriented products to them. I think that era is fundamentally over, So today, in terms of, again, my lens of what's coming to us as a VC, it's very much about transactions, it's about commerce, and it's about marketplaces. I think the other thing is the app stores and the app environment doesn't really lend itself to an advertising orientation. We've all lamented that on mobile, advertising monetizes far less than it does on PC, laptops, and everything else like that. So you have to come up with other forms of monetization. And transaction/commerce is the dominant model there. So today's new generation of entrepreneurs, they're all about delivering an end-to-end solution to a question, an answer, or a task. So if you think of Uber, which you guys are going to be talking a lot about, this whole genre is about on-demand, it's about marketplaces, but it's about fulfilling something. You have a need, you're actually going to go execute on it. You're not going to find information about it and then go execute on it. So there's no advertising in any of those apps. It's purely a grossed-up transactional value, which is actually interesting because then these businesses have a greater pool of money to go out and acquire customers. So it's all about lifetime value, customer acquisition, and doing the math on that front. So I think fundamentally today, we don't see anyone coming in and pitching local. Local's not ever used anymore. It's frankly on demand, it's marketplaces, it's mobile-first-oriented apps where the business model is direct to consumer and it's consumer pay. And the merchant, the advertiser, the small business, whatever you want to call it, is being aggregated into a network by whoever this new consumer service is.
Yeah, within on-demand or the Uberization of kind of venture investment or that kind of a thesis, there's really two trends going on, right? On the consumer side, it is about quote-unquote on-demand, right, and ease of use and how fast can your need and your desire be fulfilled. On the other side of that equation, on the supply side, the more interesting thing going on there is the rise of what I call the 1099 economy, right? What used to be an SMB with a retail location with kind of 5 to 25 employees, now the automation of that SMB is becoming a single proprietor getting paid as a 1099 and using a platform or in 20 years term, a franchise platform in some ways that's technologized by Uber as a way to fulfill all the back-end services, and he just focused on what he does best, right? Whether that is house cleaning, driving a car, or fixing doors, right? And we're seeing that quite a lot where a lot of the supply side are no longer what I call kind of traditional SMBs, but actually kind of independent proprietors. And that's actually bottoms up disrupting the SMB space.
But, you know, I'll give you an example of a seed stage company we got involved with this year called Shuttle, based here in the Bay Area. This is, think of Uber for parents with kids. You know, I have two kids, elementary school age. My wife and I can't be full-time chauffeurs, take them around to soccer practice and this after-school activity, et cetera. But Shuttle is basically a car scheduled service where you could have your child get picked up and dropped off here and there. It's effectively, you know, an alternative to parent-organized carpooling, et cetera. The 1099 folks are actually moms. So the only drivers in Shuttle's network are women. Vigorously background checked, and the founder of Shuttle was one of the founders of Sidecar, so he's already had experience in building and scaling a player in that space. You know, you could argue a lot of people could go after it, absolutely, but it's totally network effect based, and once you have kind of liquidity and marketplace oriented dynamics, they're off and running. And there's examples in every vertical and sub vertical that, you know, are not going to be on the Googles and the others kind of radar.
So we're talking a lot about the uberification of a lot of these verticals. You both have some investments in that space. Maybe Michael, if you could talk about Flightcar, and Will about Roxbox.
Yeah, I mean, I gave an example about Shuttle a minute ago, which I think is our newest one. Flightcar is more about, you know, disrupting the car rental space, which is a big one. Many of you flew in, obviously, to San Francisco to attend this. You may have picked up a rental car, but, you know, they take, you know, parked vehicles at the airport and convert them into rental cars and income for people who are parking there. So, you know, you can earn some money while you're away on your trip. You probably should have done that, you know, before you left at your home airport. But, you know, it's another way to kind of get vehicle transportation kind of once you're at your destination as well. You know, every category, there's things like this, you know. And going back to our original point, that is an end-to-end solution. It's not about advertising, hey, looking for a rental car, right. You know, boom, here's five places, here's OTAs and booking engines to do it. It's like, literally, I want this car, you know, I'm going to be arriving here, here's where I go to, you know, how do I get my keys, and off I'm running. And I'm not dealing with paper forms or anything like that. It's all done through the app. So it's convenience, it's utility, it's just a different kind of consumer value prop than the one we talked about 5-6 years ago.
We have a company called Blue Nation that is a marketplace for local forests. Now, from the kind of 30,000 foot level perspective, it seems like, well, what's the difference? What's the innovation there, right? A couple things happening kind of in that space. One is the wire services of the world are using the local forests simply as a fulfillment shop, right? So there is a disincentive for floors to kind of really build a business on top of FTD or 1-800-Flowers. The other side of that equation, what's going on is that actually about 30% of the forests that's on Blue Nation actually don't even have a physical presence offline at all, right? Mm-hmm. They work out of their apartment. They work out of some workspace that they rented. And they have some guy doing the delivery, and they, you know, make flower arrangements in the back, right? For them, they can have a much better infrastructure and cost of infrastructure if they don't have to pay the $10,000 rent in the local kind of downtown, right? And using kind of Blue Nation as a way to market and using the delivery mechanism as a way to do fulfillment, they can actually really upend the business model of a local forest and then make very good money doing it. And we're seeing that quite a lot where, you know, the local forest used to be one guy with kind of four people working for him or her, and the four person that's working for him or her ended up kind of quitting their job and coming onto kind of Blue Nation and building a business on their own, right? So transactional is kind of where you can create that end-to-end experience and really create differentiation versus search versus Google, who will be kind of really hard pressed to kind of get in as deep as that, right? Because that's really not their business model. They're a media company. And as you look at both the consumer disruption and the supply side kind of business disruption, there's multiple verticals in which you can go into and using kind of this type of playbook. And you know, anything from selling your kids to selling flowers. There are billions and billions and billions of dollars at each and every single one of these supposedly small verticals if you just can get to the transactional level.